And thank you so much for joining us for CBN NewsWatch. I'm Ephraim Graham. Ahead today, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu saying absolute victory over Hamas is within reach, making that declaration after Israel rejects Hamas's demands for hostage releases, which Netanyahu called delusional. Hamas infiltrated Israel before its attacks on October 7th. Now, a new documentary warns terrorists are also right here in the U.S. and could be prepared to strike. And how one church is reaching out to the U.S. military by planting churches near bases around the world. All those stories and more ahead today, right here on CBN NewsWatch.
This is CBN NewsWatch.
I want to begin this half hour in Israel, where Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has rejected Hamas's latest terms for a ceasefire and a hostage release deal, following a meeting with U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken. The move comes amid pressure to find a way to get the hostages out, and Netanyahu is promising absolute victory for Israel within months. CBN Middle East correspondent Julie Stahl brings us the story. She's in Jerusalem.
Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu rejected Hamas's demands and says military pressure is the best option for gaining the release of about 100 hostages and the recovery of 30 bodies still held by Hamas.
Surrendering to Hamas's delusional demands that we heard now not only won't lead to freeing the captives, it will just invite another massacre. It will invite a major disaster on the state of Israel that none of our citizens would want to accept.
Hamas terms included releasing hostages and bodies in three phases over a period of months in exchange for an unspecified amount of Palestinian prisoners, including those serving life sentences for murdering Israelis. It also called for more humanitarian aid for Gaza and a complete Israeli withdrawal from the Gaza Strip. Netanyahu says Israel will achieve complete victory within a matter of months.
The IDF creates wonders and is moving forward in a systematic way to get all the goals of the war that we, at the political level, required from it. The elimination of Hamas, the release of all hostages, and the promise that Gaza won't be a threat to Israel anymore.
After meeting with Netanyahu Wednesday, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken met with the Israeli War Cabinet and opposition leader Yair Lapid today. He says the U.S. focused on releasing the hostages and discussed the Hamas response with Israeli leaders.
What I can tell you about these discussions is that while there are some clear non-starters in Hamas's response, we do think it creates space for agreement to be reached. And we will work at that relentlessly until we get there.
The hostage crisis is putting pressure on the Israeli government. Just after Netanyahu dismissed Hamas's terms, six women, former hostages who were freed in November, publicly called on him to accept any deal.
The price is heavy. The price is unbearable. The price shrinks the stomach and body. But the price of neglect will become a historical stain for generations. Neglect will become synonymous for those who will issue a death sentence to those who were left and were kidnapped under their leadership.
Elsewhere in the region, a U.S. drone strike reportedly killed three members of an Iranian-backed militia, including a high-ranking leader. The strike is part of an ongoing retaliation against Iranian assets in the region that have attacked U.S. forces and most recently killed three U.S. service members. Julie Stahl, CBN News, Jerusalem.
CBN News Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell is joining us now from Jerusalem with more. So, Chris, Netanyahu is talking about complete victory in a matter of months. How does the Israeli military plan to accomplish that?
Well, Ephraim, first of all, they continue to do what they're doing. They're really making unprecedented, some say historic, progress because they're fighting above the ground and they're fighting below the ground. We were in a tunnel just a few days ago in Khan Yunis. The general who gave us that briefing and tour explained that they've had to learn and evolve in their tactics to go ahead and fight this kind of historic battle. And they're doing much better than reported. Now, what they have to do now is go from Khan Yunis, where they are now, on their way to Rafah, Rafah while protecting the civilians in the area. There's estimated more than 1 million that have fled from the north and the central part of Gaza Strip down to Rafah. Now, the general, as I was saying, he told us they're doing everything they can to protect civilians. He's even giving the enemy exactly telling him where he's going to go. Well, on the other hand, Hamas and Sinwar, their leader, puts their civilians between him and the IDF. So they're really making progress. I think it's underreported, but we'll see how they continue to go and how long this war in Gaza will go.
Chris, the U.S. Secretary of State was critical of the Israeli Defense Forces during his visit. What did he say, and how was that received?
Well, Ephraim, one thing he said is that Israelis were dehumanized on October 7th, dehumanized by the hostages being kept well over 100 days now. But he also said there's no reason to dehumanize the Palestinians in Gaza during the war. It's probably his harshest rebuke yet of all the things he said, particularly about the IDF. He said the majority of people in Gaza had nothing to do with those attacks on October 7th. But I think Israelis would respond by what the IDF has discovered. Almost in every house they've gone through in Gaza, they found weapons, they found materials showing civilians agreed with or supported October 7th. Recently, we're in Kfar Aza, one of the main kibbutzim on the border that was attacked. We heard that after the terrorists came on October 7th, ordinary civilians flooded into the kibbutzim and Kfar Aza. Blinken also said that he wants more aid to come in, but what's happened is that Hamas is stealing most of that aid, and that's why Israelis are trying to block the aid coming in, not because they don't want humanitarian aid, but they just don't want the aid going to Hamas that puts their own soldiers, sons and daughters, in harm's way.
The Israeli government is under pressure from hostages' families to get the remaining captives out, some say at any price. Where does the public stand on releasing the hostages versus continuing the war?
Well, to some degree, Ephraim, the public right now is divided. I would say most don't want a deal with Hamas at any price. Everybody wants to get the hostages out, but they don't want to lose sight of the goal of defeating Hamas. It's a very emotional issue, as you can tell by that soundbite we played in Julie's report. In some ways, Hamas is really pitting Israelis against one another. It's all part of their emotional and psychological warfare. But this particular deal, Ephraim, really was a non-starter. It had so many demands on Israel to really basically end the war and have Hamas revitalized. Defense Minister Yoav Gallant told Blinken himself that he felt it was designed so Israel would have to refuse it, and thus putting more pressure on Netanyahu and his government.
Iran is the ultimate enemy in all of this for Israel. Now a new report says Iran could build a nuclear weapon in 1 week. Does Israel consider that realistic, and does it have a plan for dealing with a nuclear Iran?
Well, I think it does feel like the intelligence is accurate, and it certainly has plans to deal with the nuclear Iran. They've had years, probably a couple of decades, to prepare for a nuclear Iran. The question is when and how close they will determine how Iran is to a bomb. Right now, they have to deal with Hamas, and then the next big target for Israel is north to Hezbollah, and all this without losing sight of the main threat, a nuclear Iran, which presents an existential threat to Israel.
All right, Chris Mitchell reporting from Jerusalem. Thank you so much. Our prayers for you and the entire team there, that you remain safe. Coming up, and as Israel is at war after the deadly Hamas attacks on October 7th, a new documentary reports terrorists are already here in the United States, ready to strike. We're going to hear from the director of the film when we come back. Stay with us. You're watching CBN NewsWatch.
Download the CBN News app. One place for all of your news. Breaking news alerts. Watch CBN News Channel Live. CBN News. Because truth matters. Get the CBN News app today.
On October 7th, Hamas terrorists proved they could easily infiltrate Israel. But what about the United States? The director of a new documentary film called America Invaded says she's interviewed terrorists who are already present in the U.S. to instigate attacks. Nimrata Sing Gujral believes U.S. action against Iran could cause them to speed up their plans.
Yes, we definitely have threats from Hamas and Hezbollah. And I mean, think about, why wouldn't you? They went to Israel. They were able to get in there, infiltrate the villages, and wreak the havoc that they did. And you've got a wide open border. I mean, this is actually, it's easier to get into the U.S. than it is into Israel. I think it's the Islamic fundamentalists. There's various different organizations, Hamas and Hezbollah being just two of them. You've got ISIS-K, you've got Houthi rebels now, you've got the Jaish-e-Mohammed and the, other sort of different parts of the world from Pakistan, et cetera. So I think what I like to just say is jihadists, Islamic fundamentalists. And their ideology is the same. We actually talk about in the film, we talk about what all of these groups have in common. And we talk about the ideology that speaks to infidels or non-believers who should be punished, who should be killed unless they're under your rule and they pay a tax called jizya. And we actually have a couple of Islamic, very well-known Islamic authorities in the film that speak to this. And it's scary. Very scary.
Well, the U.S. right now is continuing to launch retaliatory military strikes inside Yemen, Iraq, and Syria. What's the likelihood that the terrorists that have gone undetected crossing the southern border, the gotaways that you mentioned, may launch attacks right here inside the U.S. if the U.S. bombs targets, let's say, inside Iran?
I don't think it's going to necessarily instigate them to do it so much, because I think that they're here to instigate those attacks. Do I think it's going to maybe fast track it? Absolutely. But remember, we started doing this 2 years ago and we've sort of followed the path, and we actually show you some interviews in the film of terrorists actually being in the U.S. I think they're here. The sleeper cells are here. Unfortunately, and I say this with a great deal of remorse, we will see another 9/11, unfortunately, and I'm so sad to say this, we will.
Well, it seems like it's heading that direction. And in your film, America Invaded, you talked to veterans, Gold Star families, who told you about their suffering and their sacrifice. Do you think it was worth it, or are they bitter and resentful? What do they think?
I don't think these people can ever be bitter and resentful just because of who they are. I have never served in the military. I'm a Democrat, believe it or not. I'm not a complete crazy leftist. I'm somewhere in the middle. I do believe Americans should come together. I just did an interview and they asked me, why are you still a Democrat? Because the Democrat Party is a mess. I'm not sure I'm going to vote Democrat in 2024, but someone needs to stick around to fix the party. What is happening at our border should concern every single American. Going back to the veterans, I think when people serve in the military, they're Democrats and Republicans, largely, I think, conservative, but there are some liberals there. But I think the way they look at serving their country goes well beyond sacrifice and well beyond regret and resentment. What I will tell you is this. The Biden administration, and I speak to Mr. Biden, President Biden, as a Democrat who has been a longtime Democrat. President Biden, you are unraveling the legacy and the heroism of all of our troops that were killed and wounded in the global war on terror in Iraq and Afghanistan. Do not do this. It's not worth winning an election to unravel that legacy.
Well, in addition to free housing, New York City's launching a $53 million pilot program to give undocumented immigrant families prepaid debit cards. So what about homeless veterans? Are they getting the help they need? What have you discovered?
So released another picture 2 years ago. It was called America's Forgotten. It's on Amazon Prime. A homeless veteran basically says, sometimes we just feel like we're used. We're used as pawns to go, we're told to go protect America and sent to these foreign territories, which they don't mind going, by the way. And then you just leave the floodgates open on the home front of giving out these free handouts to illegal immigrants versus perhaps the people that have served and come back and need the help desperately to live their day-to-day lives. And they want an explanation.
Nimrata Sing Gujral, thanks for taking the time to share with us. God bless you and your efforts.
AmericaInvadedFilm.com. Thank you very much.
Also on this week's episode of The Global Lane, as the U.S. attacks Houthi rebels, Christians in Yemen endure hardship and possible death, and a look at the motive behind the propaganda of the October 7th Truther Movement, which says Israel, not Hamas, was actually behind those attacks. You can watch The Global Lane this evening on the CBN News Channel. It begins at 8 Eastern. You can also see it on the CBN News app, or you can watch it on YouTube. Now, here's a quick look at some other stories in the news at this hour. The Supreme Court will hear former President Trump's appeal today. After four justices in the Colorado Supreme Court ruled he should be disqualified under a section of the Constitution because he incited the Capitol Hill riot on January 6th of 2021. Trump's attorneys argue the amendment can't be used to keep him off the ballot. Federal cybersecurity agencies say hackers sponsored have been able to access some critical U.S. infrastructure for at least 5 years. The agency believes the hackers want to be in place on IT networks for cyber attacks in case there's a major crisis or conflict within the United States. Still ahead, a church in North Carolina working to reach members of the U.S. military and around the world by planting churches near their bases. We're going to bring you the stories coming up right after this. A North Carolina church has started a mission to reach the U.S. military on a worldwide scale. Its goal is to plant a church close to as many bases as possible. Mark Martin is on this story.
From post-traumatic stress to longer and more frequent deployments away from family, it's clear our military men and women need support. And just like how God miraculously supplied food to Israelites in the wilderness, Manna Church is stepping up to provide spiritual and mental nourishment for those who serve our country stationed around the world.
I think it speaks to the power of a promise from God. I believe that God gave my dad a vision, God gave my dad a promise, and I think that it's been my honor to lay my life down to fulfill the vision that God gave my dad.
Manna Church, pastored by Christopher Fletcher, is in Fayetteville, North Carolina, near Fort Liberty, one of the Army's largest installations. Fletcher says God gave to his father, Michael, a vision of how to reach the military almost a decade ago after the church lost more than 1,100 people to military transfers in just 1 year.
And so he kind of sat back in his chair and said, you know, this is crazy. Like, how are we going to build a church this way? We're sending people that God's beginning a work in to nobody. There are great churches at military bases. I'm not saying that, but he said, I'm tired of sending us to nobody. And so that vision was really birthed in December of 2014. And from that point forward, we've been seeking to plant an expression of Manna Church near every U.S. military installation in the world.
That would entail church plants near 273 bases that Fletcher calls the military highway.
The thing I love about 273 is it's not a vision I can accomplish. It's not wisdom that is going to be somehow inherent in me that's going to come bubbling to the surface. It requires God to move. That sort of drive gets me up in the morning. I think more believers should have God-sized visions that are terrifying when you look at them.
Currently, there are 33 expressions of Manna Church near U.S. military bases, as shown in the map behind me. The greatest concentration is here in North Carolina and in Virginia, but locations are spread out around the country and even overseas. Army Reservist First Lieutenant Todd Capen is a site pastor in North Carolina, while Air Force Special Operations veteran Riley Halliday is a lead pastor in Virginia.
So when a military family gets orders to move, we can already set them up. They already have a network of people that they can plug into. They don't have to worry about the church search or finding a church that believes the same things.
Uncle Sam, who's kind of become our mission sending organization, because he takes great talented people and relocates them. So that's kind of the vision. We have everything from microsites, which you might think of a house church. They're live streaming or they're watching one of our city sites where there's a lead pastor, someone in my role who does preaching, teaching, discipling. And then obviously if a church grows to the right scale, it'll multi-site where there's multiple campuses in a city.
Military personnel get their orders to another location as often as every 2 years. So having another Manna Church to walk into provides continuity and support. Both executive pastor James Lewis and his wife served in the military and know what it's like to pick up and move multiple times.
My wife and I were both out in Colorado for about 4 years, and then we moved here in 2000 to Fort Bragg. And We stayed here for 6 years, but then we moved to Kansas. So we were in Kansas for 2 years. We moved back here to Fort Bragg for 3 years, to include my second deployment. Then after Fort Bragg for that second time, we moved to Baltimore, where I taught ROTC at Morgan State University. And then I went to Korea, and my family moved back here to Fort Bragg. So we were separated for a full year, and then I came back to Fort Bragg in 2015, and then retired the next year in 2016.
And that's just one example of what can be the life of a military family. So having the same type of church in different locations is definitely welcomed.
It's amazing. It is, it's a comfort, because, again, you move, you're away from family, but yet knowing that your church family is going to be there wherever you are is amazing.
To be able to transition from one base to another base, and just to know that there's a church with that exact culture, there's, like I say, it's a great thing.
Retired Army veteran Sabrina Bentley Thompson leads Manna's kids program in Fayetteville. Moving can be especially hard for children, having to make new friends and getting adjusted to new teachers.
It's probably harder on the kids than it is on the parents. Knowing that you're changing stations, you're going somewhere else, and just to know that, hey, I'm used to this.
Familiarity, community, mental and spiritual nourishment, all elements of stability that Manna Church provides for military families on a journey full of unknowns. Mark Martin, CBN News, North Carolina and Virginia.
Coming back with an encouraging word for your day ahead. Stay with us. Welcome back. Time now for your Thursday Thankful. And today I invite you to join me in this prayer of gratitude and song. You may be familiar with the lyrics. Oh, Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I seek. For when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. I'll add to that, his eyes are on us. May we keep our eyes on him as he keeps his eyes on us. Amen and amen. Well, that will do it for this edition of CBN NewsWatch. You can always find more of our news programs on the CBN News Channel. You can find them there at any time as well as online, cbnnews.com. Take a minute. Let us know what you think about the stories you've seen here today or any day. You can do that by emailing us. The address is newswatch@cbn.com. And of course, you can reach out and touch us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We'll see you back here tomorrow.